You can stand. Who here went to sleep after 2 a.m.? Stand if you went to sleep after 2 a.m. All right. If you went to bed after 4 a.m., you can remain standing. Wow. There's like a whole youth group over here. All right, if you went to bed after 6 a.m., stay standing. All right, well, for those of you that... I have a prize here for the first person to get up here that went to bed after 6 a.m. I've got a prize for you if you come and get it. All right, we got them. What's your name? Caleb. And where's your chaperone? Have your chaperone stand. I've got something for him too, because he's going to need some coffee. Let's give Caleb a round of applause. All right, I got a couple announcements for you. Everybody look to this, my right, back right corner. Everybody wave to Seth. We want you all to make your way over there after the service and get your picture taken in front of the P7 banner and then have it hashtagged on your Twitter or Instagram, hashtag WYC16, and you could win some free P7 gear. Everybody say, yeah! Also, if you are a P7 leader here in Wisconsin, Seth Boyd needs to gather some information from you, so please connect with him following service today. Also, if you stop by our CMI table out in the hall, you can register for a free CD, so make sure you stop by the CMI desk after service this morning. Also, if you were part of the Big Ten VIP and get your picture taken in front of the P7 banner and then have it hashtagged on your Twitter or Instagram,
they had a delicious breakfast this morning,
and you were able to join the youth committee some free P7 gear.
So if you are not part of the Big Ten VIP challenge, make sure you are part of that this upcoming year.
If you are a P7 leader here in Wisconsin,
in terms of Chiefs for Christ,
Seth Boyd needs to gather
Wisconsin
some information.
District this past year raised $110,000 for Chiefs for Christ. Give yourselves a round of applause for that. So here's my challenge to you for this upcoming year. Stop by the Chiefs for Christ booth out in the hallway and pick up one of those Chiefs for Christ cans and start filling them up today. And bring these Chiefs for Christ cans to our Chiefs for Christ kickoff rally in Madison, Wisconsin on April 7th. Make sure every one of you is there. Who's going to the Chiefs for Christ kickoff rally? All right. So fill up those cans. Make sure you bring them to that rally. Also, did any of you see the t-shirts out in the hallway? Your Refresh t-shirts. Well, if you were procrastinating buying a t-shirt until today or tomorrow, well, it's gonna pay off because the t-shirts are now only $10 today. So make sure you stop by and pick up one of those. All right, one last and final announcement. Everyone say 10 a.m. What time does church start tomorrow morning? What time? Not 10:30, right? 10 a.m. So make sure that you are here at 10 a.m. And before you come to church, you need to be checked out of your hotel room. If you need a place to keep your luggage, the room directly across from the auditorium here will be open, so you can store your luggage in there. But make sure that you are checked out of your hotel room by 10 a.m. Lastly, I want you all to chant after me. Shane, 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 Shane. And let's welcome Shane Mackey.
So I think the lesson learned here is that procrastination pays off. If you didn't buy your t-shirt, you get a discount. So that means next year you wait till the next day. I think I just got fired. I'm here on behalf of Hyphen. This is fun. If I just wait for the awkward moment, you guys start cheering. Oh. I do want to get serious for 1 second. When we look at the Bible, we read the history of Israel. We read it in Judges and Kings and Chronicles. When we look at it, we get a sobering lesson. Far too often, when we go through those books, we read about the failure of the next generation. Over and over, we read that they did what was right in their own eyes. They didn't follow after the ways of God. They didn't follow after the ways of David, the kings before them that did what was right. We do find that a king or a judge would rise up that would serve God, and that generation would take up their cause and follow after God. But the next generation would simply forget, mirroring their destinies to that of the Egyptian king who the Bible says knew not Joseph. The message we see in the Bible seems to be that the next generation simply forgets. But I'm thankful there's also another message in the Bible, one that bridges that gap between the generations. It goes from Moses to Joshua, from Naomi to Ruth, from Paul to Timothy, and ultimately from Jesus to his disciples, and is best embodied in Jesus' call to them to follow me. It's a message of discipleship. And on March 10th and 11th in Madison, Wisconsin, we're going to have our 2017 Hyphen Conference. And the theme of this conference is going to be Jesus' call to follow me. If you're 18 to 30, 35-ish, don't worry, we're not going to card you. You can still show up. But you don't want to miss this conference. You don't want to miss this opportunity to be trained by some of our greatest leaders in our organization. We're so privileged to have Brother Aaron Soto and Brother Stan Gleason coming to teach us for 2 days on the topic of discipleship. That's on March 10th and 11th. Make sure if you're in that age group, if you want to grow, if you're interested in making sure you don't become just another Pentecostal statistic, sign up. It's live now on Facebook. Go to the Wisconsin District Hyphen page. Sign up for the conference and make sure you're there to get taught. God bless.
Red one.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them
the word. And then Philip opened his mouth, and began the same scripture which he read unto Jesus. And as they went on,
Peter said unto them,
they came closer and more.
Good morning, Wisconsin youth. Please, please hold the applause. Let me introduce us, first of all. We are John and Kristen Contino, and we're here to promote senior Bible quizzing. I wonder if we could have those of you that have ever participated in a Bible quiz tournament as a quizzer or as a coach to please stand up. Yeah, these are our heroes. So for the rest of you, go and do likewise. I should just drop the mic and walk off here. You may be seated. So for those of you who may not be familiar with senior Bible quizzing, what is it? Well, it's first Bible and, of course, quizzing. So senior Bible quizzing is really the serious business of systematically memorizing and hiding God's word in your heart, combined with the excitement and often nail-biting excitement of tournament quizzing against quizzers and teams from other churches. So typically once a month, January through June, is when we have these tournaments. This year is a significant year for Bible quizzing. As a ministry, we're celebrating 50 years. Why don't you give senior Bible quizzing a hand? So for any ministry to last that long, you know it's doing something. And I can tell you from personal experience as a quizzer and from observing the lives of so many who have come through the quiz program that it is transforming lives. It's the living word of God, and that's what it's intended to do. So it's the 50th anniversary. This year's quiz theme is rooted. Rooted. And our quiz material is from the book of Acts. That's our spiritual DNA. That's where we have our roots. That's where we see what the apostles did. And are we apostolic? We want to do the same thing. So it's significant that the theme for WYC this year is refresh. And maybe some of you have noticed that it's found in Acts chapter 3, verse 19. I think some of you can probably quote that, Acts 3:19. So why refresh? And I know Brother Meyer had already presented that. Someone help me out. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. So that's refresh. And so maybe you ask, Why should I consider
being involved in Bible quizzing? Is anyone interested in being used by God?
I know you are.
You wouldn't be here if you weren't interested in receiving more from God, being used by Him. Are you interested in being rooted in your faith, strong in your faith?
How about just being interested in rubbing shoulders and having fellowship with others with that same faith that you have? And for our youth leaders, wouldn't you want all of that for your youth, for them to be rooted, to not only be ministering to them, but they can minister with you because they've got a foundation in the Word of God? So I want to leave you with a challenge. It's a twofold challenge. Are you ready to accept the challenge, become part of this senior Bible quizzing revolution? The first challenge is, proof is in the pudding, isn't it? So when we talk about availing ourselves for ministry, being used by God, what is it that we minister? Well, we minister His Word. And so my challenge for you is commit to memory, Acts chapter 3, verse 19, and there's a reward for you. Come by our booth, quote that verse to us. We'd like to get to know you and add your name to a drawing for some of these t-shirts, the refresh t-shirts. So yeah, if you hold off long enough, you might be able to get a free t-shirt. Otherwise, they're going up to $15 after we distribute the t-shirts. Just kidding about that. So that's the first challenge. How many of you would like to accept that challenge? How many of you think you can? It starts by thinking you can. I know some of you already have. In fact, I know Mariah Tompkins, where are you? You've already quoted to me, Mariah, so your name is in the drawing already. But that's your first challenge. You want to be used by God? Well, you can take that first step by memorizing His Word. And then the second challenge to you is come visit one of our tournaments. We have a schedule of where the tournaments are. There's going to be a tournament nearby you at some point. Please, if you've never seen a quiz tournament, never been involved, we invite you to come. Lord bless you.
Amen. Can we all stand to our feet right now and lift our hands unto the Lord? There's already a powerful presence of God in this room. God, we invite you. Lord, we make room for you this morning, Jesus. We open our hearts, our minds to you, God, that you would have your way and do exactly what it is you would desire to do in this place. Jesus, have your way in us, God. Move, mighty breath of God, blow in this place, Jesus. We give you all of our praise, God.
You are good. Good when there's nothing good in me. You are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sins.
Yes, Jesus.
You are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting.
I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign.
Yes, God.
And you are more. Than my words will ever say. And you are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. Yeah.
heart will sing.
No other name but the name of Jesus. No other name but the name of Jesus.
Current of the presence of God. Can we lift our voices right now? Oh God, we magnify you. Lord, we glorify you. No other name but your name. We run to you, Jesus. Oh, we run to you, Jesus. Oh, we run to your altar, God.
Sing hallelujah,
Christ is risen.
That's good. Lift your voice.
Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Yeah. We sing hallelujah to you, Lord. We sing hallelujah to you, Lord. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior, sir.
Oh, what a Savior.
Thank you.
Just begin to utter the name of Jesus. Just begin to worship the name of Jesus. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's none beside Him. That's it. Just begin to worship Him in your own voice. God, we love You, Lord. God, we praise You today. Lord, we worship You. God, You're the risen Savior, the King of Kings. Of His people. Yes. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. What a powerful name. The name of Jesus. At the name we have healing. At the name we have salvation. Hallelujah. You may return to your seats. Hallelujah. Why don't we worship Him? Why don't we thank Him for what we just heard? We love You, Jesus. God, we praise You today. We thank You, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Wow. What an incredible convention we've already had. I think we haven't been here not even 24 hours yet. Have you been touched by God? We had a wonderful encounter with God last night. Thank you, Brother Brown, for being sensitive to the Holy Ghost. I don't want to belabor anything today. I'm here to introduce our speaker for today. We are going to honor Brother and Sister Demas tonight. This is their last year as our youth secretary. And we are honored this past youth camp to hear from Sister Fiona Demas. And we are so incredibly honored today to hear from Brother Phil Demas. If any of you have spent time with Brother Demas, you know him and his wife. They are the real deal. They love Jesus. They love people. And I remember my first encounter with Brother Demas. Maybe not my first, but I remember coming to a winter youth convention, and I remember a man dressing up in all black with an A across his chest and a rainbow fro and a cape. And he was announcement man. Forever changed my life. And how I looked at announcements. If you get to know Phil, you'll know that he has a love for people. He has a love for God. He has a love for his family. But he also has a love for Legos. And so today, as we bring him up to the platform, we thought we could invite him and have him preach behind this normal pulpit. Or we could get a Lego pulpit.
And so I'm going to ask our gentlemen to come, and we're going to do a quick exchange. And as Brother Demas comes to the platform, why don't we give Brother Demas a round of applause? Thank him for his commitment and service to Wisconsin.
Everything is awesome. So I've heard of that legend, about the legend of announcement, man. I don't know. You know how legends start. You know, I'm sure it was just some guy that came up and just to do the announcements, and in the back someone was like, man, that guy can do announcements. And as the story unfolded and years go by and the oral history of that one night, and like, man, that man was awesome. He was an announcement man, and soon it grew into, you know, there was hair and there was a cape. So I don't know. It's just a legend. Don't know who that was. But glory, it isn't in the past. Under the blood. It's been my honor for the This is going to take some getting used to. It's been my honor the past few years to serve all of you as a section rep in Section 3 and as the start, and then now as a youth secretary. I give honor to our youth president, David Meyer, for his leadership. He has a vision for the future of Wisconsin Youth Ministries, and I appreciate him allowing me to speak one last time in an official capacity this morning. I give honor to our youth committee, some of the best guys and gals that you'd ever meet, some of my very best friends. I want to thank my wife, Fiona. She drove up this morning. We've had some sickness in our house this week, and drove up today to be with us. She's been my rock, my number one fan, my biggest encourager and supporter. I love her dearly, love her with all my heart. And lastly, I give honor to you guys, giving up a couple days to come to Appleton, spend time together, enjoy the amazing shop downstairs and the great customer service. And, you know, we just, it's a joke. You're the reason why we're here. Amen. I heard a speaker at Youth Congress many years ago that said something that has helped me in my life, and he said that I can only be me, I can't be someone else, and he proceeded to preach a message in his own style, not a Youth Congress type message that you would think to hear, and it was him, that's how he was, that's his style, and so I echo that this morning in my final opportunity to speak to you as Youth Secretary. To the young people, young adults of Wisconsin, I'm just going to be me, speak from my heart. It's how I've always been. I don't know any other way to do it. If you know anything about me, like David said, you know that I am an avid Lego collector. And so this morning, I want to speak on the topic, Lego Lessons from P. Hill. It's my rap name, P. Hill. So Lego Lessons from P. Hill. You may be seated if I could get some help. Amen. Legos are an interesting toy that have been around since 1958. A long time ago, the first Lego brick was produced at that time. Legos are part of a universal system, which means that regardless of the year a Lego piece was made or the set it belongs to, each piece is compatible with other existing pieces. A piece from 1958 would fit perfectly with the winter holiday train that I bought last month. To accommodate the universal system, you can imagine that Legos are toys of precision. A basic one-by-one flat piece, like I have on my phone. Yes, I do have a Lego phone case. The smallest one-by-one piece, I do have a Lego tie. I do have a Lego. Anyways, Lord help my children. I'm like Mr. Business, like, don't touch my Legos. So I'm like the naysayer. Boo. I won't glue them together. Maybe someday. No, but a basic 1x1 is 3.2 millimeters high, 7x8 millimeters wide and long. The knob is exactly 1.7 millimeters high. If it was a 2x1 piece, it would be 8 millimeters from the center of each knob to the next knob, one knob to the next. And so it's very precise. They come in all shapes and sizes. They're sold in groupings of just random pieces, or they are more commonly sold in sets, as you can see up here. They are classic set themes like Space City, Castle, Pirates. I'm kind of particular to those. There's other licensed themes that have come out in the past dozen years, like Star Wars, Batman. And the latest push, which I think was genius marketing move, are the Lego sets geared toward the ladies with the Friends theme and the Princess themes. And I wish I had a girl to have an excuse to buy those, but I don't. Maybe someday, Lord. Legos are used for creating life-size sculptures. I don't know if you've been to the Mall of America, Lego store. Huge Legos that thousands and thousands I was just at Disney Springs in Orlando a couple weeks ago. They have the classic dragon that's like 40 feet tall, long, and it goes up and down, in and out of the water. And so today I brought some of my favorite Legos from my collection. First is the Volkswagen camper van. This actually pops up like, whoop, okay. 1,300 pieces, came out in 2011. Lots of cool features. I won't go into them. You can go online and watch the videos if you really are interested. And if you're thinking about coming and stealing my minifigures, I left them all at home. So you Lego fans out there, nice try. We have the Imperial Flagship 2010, probably one of my favorite Lego. It's an 8-gun boat destroying the pirates. It's about 1,600 pieces. Came out in 2010. Temple of Erjitsu right here. This is a ninja theme. Probably one of those coolest features is the shadow puppet. I can show you later. Shadow puppet theater. 2015 came out. 2,000 pieces. The Ferris wheel, pretty rocking one. About 2,600 pieces came out last year. And then the Parisian restaurant at the end. This is a modular Lego. It actually comes apart in different pieces, and you can see inside. And there's different themes. Like this is a dentist office or something inside. Very detailed inside, and you can connect all the pieces and make this huge city. Someday, my basement will be that way. And that's the biggest Lego here, 2,469 pieces. Each one of these have a different function. They have different features, different shapes, different colors. Look around you this morning. And one next to you, then one beside you, behind you. I see young people of all ages, sizes, color, background, family structure, heights, widths. Each of you are different. And God wants to shape you. He wants to mold you. He wants to create you into this masterpiece. We don't know what the end product will be in our lives, but no matter what piece he puts in our lives, we can be assured that it will fit perfectly and connect to everything else in our lives. No piece he puts in your life will not fit. Psalms 139, my favorite book of the Bible, chapter of the Bible, verse 13 to 18 says, "You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous, God. How well I know it. You watch me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. Before you were born, while you're in your mother's womb, God was starting to shape you." The first lesson we can learn this morning from Legos is that you are a masterpiece in progress. And every piece in your life perfectly fits. As we sang last night, you're a good, good father. You are perfect in all of your ways. The questions arise of why things happen in my life, or why the situations that I face, why maybe the hurt and pain and the lot in life I was given. Why did my parents split up? Why did things that are out of our control? But Jesus fits things perfectly in your life and is shaping you if you allow him. 3 years ago, I spoke here the same morning at Winter Youth and talked about how life can just knock you in your teeth and you have no control over the situation. I was vulnerable that morning and spoke about the inability of Fiona and I to have children, which was a very big blow to us. Well, let me show you the perfect peace that God had for our lives. Where are you, Bubs? This is Josiah Alec Demas, born last year. Hey, bub. No, you can't touch the Legos. They're daddy's Legos. You have your own. But this kid is perfect. You know, 3 years ago I spoke and we were going through a lot of questions in our lives. It's like, why us? Why now? Why? What? This doesn't make sense, God. But Josiah is a perfect fit. His personality for our family, his temperament for our family, like people say he looks like me. I mean, he's adorable. Of course he looks like me. It's like, you know, like, thank you. But some of the things he does, he sneezes out of control like 20 times, just like daddy. I think he's going to be left-handed like mommy. Hi. Amen. But Josiah is the perfect fit. And if we had pushed and prodded, it may never have happened, but God knew the exact peace. And he's a daddy's boy. So watch this. I love you. Poor kid hasn't seen me in a day and a half. Yes, I'm a mean father. I'm a mean, mean father. I'm sorry, son. Break my heart. Oh, man. You are a masterpiece, and his pieces are perfect for your life. What is one thing that comes with every Lego set? It's the instruction manual. It gives step-by-step directions of how to build, how to construct the Lego. See, I'm not a freelancer. Some of you guys, Lego fans, are like, oh, look at this thing I built. I'm horrible at that. I like to follow the instruction. I'm like Mr. like the Lego man, actually. I follow the instruction. I'm not a master builder. Give me the instructions. That's what I want. But I like to peruse through it when I get a new set and look ahead and look at the pieces that are coming up and how they, like, how do they get that? How do they construct that? And the cool building techniques that are used. And so the second lesson we can learn from Legos this morning is that our lives are not like that. There are no instructions to see what God has intended for our lives 20, 30 years down the road. We can't see the final product. Psalms 119, 105 says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Our instruction manual, the word of God, does not lay every piece out before us, but here in Psalms we're told it's like a lamp that sheds light unto our feet. In my mind, when I read this verse, I think of the time I've driven in a snowstorm. We've all been there. When it's a torrential downpour, where the car lights only give enough light to see the white stripe. As long as I can glimpse, I know I'm not going off the road. But all you can see is that very next few feet in front of you. Or Milwaukee, genius orange stripes. I was driving that the other day through the snowstorm. Thank you, Milwaukee. But you can't see far down the road because of the snow or the pouring rain. But you have enough light just to see the next few feet to make sure you're not going off the deep end. It's the same way in our lives. We truly can only see enough for a couple pieces at most. But oftentimes, just the next piece that will be added. Think about it. If you knew that God wanted you, the Imperial flagship actually has two parts to it. It's massive. I think some of them I've had three manuals for one set. If you actually got that and knew what God wanted for your life,
but you can't see far down the road because of the snow and the pouring rain, but you have enough light I'll never see the next few feet to make sure you're not going off the deep end.
No way. Give up family. Give at least.
It's the same way in our lives.
No way,
we truly.
God. But he doesn't show you the end result. He shows you the next step and the next step and the next step. And maybe 10 years down the road, you will be a missionary. But by that time, you're like, this is what God's called me. He's put all these pieces and boom, boom, boom. So be thankful you can't see the end result. But it would behoove us to place a high value on that next piece. Each piece that we allow to be added is vitally important. And that is why God wants to be the God of your next piece. He wants to be the one that directs us, guides us, leads us. He wants his word to be the lamp unto our feet so we go in the right direction. The Bible says in Psalms 51:5, behold, I was shaped in iniquity and sin did my mother conceive me. So we have a propensity to sin. In Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And then in speaking of folks who don't listen to the wisdom of God, Proverbs 1:31 says that, therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. Left to ourselves, our own way, our own pieces, we will turn down toward a path we really don't want to go. A path that leads to eternal judgment on our souls. Why? Because we're simply born in sin. We have that propensity. We're going to go down that path. And so God wants to be God of the next piece. Why? Because he's righteous. He's holy. He is good. And as David said to the Lord in Psalms 139, he will lead me in the way everlasting. So lesson number two, there's no instruction manual. It's just the next piece in your life. If you didn't have the box for your Legos, you didn't have the instructions to a Lego set. As soon as you open the bag of Lego pieces, you may not know what the final creation would be, but it would be pretty evident what it was not going to be. For example, if you opened it up and you got a set of wheels, yes, the top comes off. Hallelujah. But if you got a set of wheels, you know, immediately you might not know it's the camper van. You might not know if it's a, you know, a truck or a car or something like that. But for sure you know you're not getting a flagship. Because flagships don't have wheels. Except in probably the Lego movie, which, you know, they make everything weird. But you know you're not getting a flagship. You know you're not getting a Ferris wheel. You know you're not getting a Parisian restaurant. It's evident what you're not going to be building that day. And that's where we can get into trouble, young people, young adults. We see the pieces in our lives and may not know what God wants us to be, but we know what we're not. And too often that can lead us to feeling poorly about our value because of who we're not going to be because of our pieces in our lives, our skills, our personalities that we don't have. Like, I could never get up and speak in front of people, and I don't have that skill, and so I'm not going to be that person. And so we're like, well, what's the use? Like, that's the ultimate high. That's the valuable person. It's inevitable that if we did a survey about youth convention this year, because we have in the past, then a comment would be made about those being used on the platform. Whatever the comment may be, positive, negative, while we seek to use those who have a good rapport, have been approved by their pastor, meet certain guidelines, there is a misplaced priority if all we come away from WYC with is who was on the platform. While they may have a larger profile, like the Ferris wheel, probably everyone in the house can see the Ferris wheel, it doesn't mean they are the most valuable in the kingdom of God. It doesn't mean that they don't have value. They have their own value just as you do, just as I do. Maybe never stepping foot on the platform in ministry. You have value to God. My most valuable Lego in my collection is on this table. If I take the original price of the Legos that I have, there's a website called Brickfolio. You can put all your Legos in there. It tells you, you put in the original price, and then it actually scans all the current sales on the secondary market and tells you the current value and give the average selling price in today's market. And I have one Lego set that has risen more in value than any other. Oh, and I forgot to mention it when I talked about the other ones. It's the Pulsar Charger, coming in at a whopping 26 pieces. Now, it's not the most expensive, but it's the most valuable Lego in my collection. 26 pieces.
It's risen 400% in value. 1990. This was what I had as a kid. My mom, somehow, she had like every Lego piece. It's amazing. I love my mom. I don't know how she did that. They're all in Ziplocs anyways. So the third lesson, Lego lesson this morning, is that our value must come from what God has in mind for our lives, not the label we give ourselves or are given by others. 1 Corinthians 12, 19 through 22 says, yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. The head can't say to the feet, I don't need you. Why? Because then where would the head go? It had no feet to walk. In fact, some parts of the body that seem weakest and least important are actually the most necessary. Lose a pinky toe and tell me how easy it is to walk. Not that I have a missing toe and I know firsthand, but I've heard the pinky toe is one of the most crucial pieces, and it's insignificant. It's seemingly insignificant. We can look at this example of the Bible. We all hear of Paul, Apostle Paul. He's the amazing role model. He was the imperial flagship of the day. Guns a-blazing. He saw hundreds get the Holy Ghost in his ministry. He did mission trips. He wrote most of the letters in the New Testament. We challenge folks to be like Paul. Aspire to be like Paul. That's the level of ministry. That's the valuable one. But has anyone heard of Ananias? Not Ananias and Sapphira, who got, like, I think they were the ones who got zapped. But not them. This other guy named Ananias. He's only mentioned once in the Bible. Acts 9, 10 through 18. There was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him the Lord said in a vision, Ananias, and he said, here am I. The Lord said to him, arise, go to the street called Straight, inquire the house of Judah for one called Saul of Tarsus. He's praying. This is the dude that's killing Christians, that hates Christians, that's going around killing. Well, the Lord strikes him blind, and now he's in this house, and God told him, hey, I'm Jesus, you're killing me, and big revelation. And so he tells the disciple, the dude is looking for folks like you, wants to kill you, go to him. Talk about like, yeah, right, God. Talk to him, pray with him so he may receive his sight. Ananias answered, Lord, I've heard from many about this man, how much harm he's done. He has the authority. But Lord said, go, for he's a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name. And Ananias went his way, entered his house, laying his hands on him and said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you came has sent me that you may receive your sight, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and Saul received his sight at once, and he rose and was baptized. Became Paul, became the mighty man that we all know about, preach about, aspire to. But without devoted disciple Ananias, who just obeyed God. Nothing else in the Bible about it. God spoke to him. There's probably some fear there. Here's a murderer, killer, and probably wants to kill me. He probably had to overcome some things, but all he did was obey God. Without Ananias, there's no missionary Bible-writing Paul. We place so much value on Paul. But who has great value? They both do. One was a high-profile Ferris wheel. Another just a Pulsar charger, but one that set history in motion. Jordan, can you come here? James, can you come here? I picked on them 3 years ago, and I'm going to pick on them again because I can. No, just joking. So, Jordan, come on up. Right up here, man. I want a picture with you. Luke, where? So, James here, he's got married this last year. Phenomenal guy. Amen. I didn't pay her. So that's good. He convinced her himself. He is on his way to becoming a journeyman electrician. He preaches. He's amazing. He's on our youth team in Madison. Just a phenomenal guy. Jordan here. He actually got engaged 3 weeks ago. Yeah. A little excited. Again, I did not pay her. He convinced her. But another phenomenal man. He's a paramedic. Saves lives. So if anyone of you keels over, we got someone. He'll save your life, put the track in, and he'll tell, use my pen and just be awesome. Can someone keel over? So no, I'll just. Phenomenal guys, careers, ministry. Looking forward to what God continues to work. But can I tell you, I knew these guys at 12. James's mother is British. His father is from Alabama originally. Redneck and a Brit. And then they were in the military, and then eventually got to Madison. Can I tell you, he was the most socially awkward kid you'd ever meet at age 12. That's why I enjoyed hanging out with him, because I was the same. But like, you'll never meet a more socially awkward person, seriously, at age 12. I remember we went to our apartment. I think it was probably one of the first events we had in our apartment. And we go in, and everyone, and we're like, oh, sweet, this is gonna be great. We're new youth pastors, and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And like 15 minutes later, I walk into our kitchen area, and there's a pantry with about this much space in it. You know, it's not like a deep pantry, just a small. And I'm standing there talking with people, and all of a sudden, the door starts opening. And I'm like, what's going on? And here's James. He opens the door, looks at me with a blank stare, and closes it back up. And I'm like, what is going on? Oh, well. Well, now Jordan. You know, on a scale of 1 to 10 for ADD, he was like, what, 20? Like, this is the most, like, hyper, like paramedic fits him, like, do nothing all day and then go save someone's life and, like just, you know, save the world and be the hero. That's Jordan. But ADD to the max. I remember we're going to Link Rally, section rally, three rally. We pull up. Vans are there for probably 15 minutes. We're loading people and stuff, and we leave. And then his mom calls, like, hey, did Jordan make the vans? And I'm like, oh, that's right. You told me he was coming. I'm like, no, I don't see him. Come to find out, he had invited a friend, and they decided to climb the tree in the front yard of the church. And he was sitting in the tree, looking at us, loading the van, and just sat there. And these are the two guys I had and about, like, 30 girls in our youth group. So I was stuck with them. Amen. You guys may be seated. The label on James, socially awkward. The label on Jordan, ADD, too hyper to be of any value. But don't let the label define your life and your value and your destiny in Christ. Jordan came to me one time. I came to him because he was being himself, and I had to correct him. And he was frustrated why people didn't, you know, like, they were, you know, basically labeling him. Why are they assuming things? I'm like, why are you acting the way you're acting? And he told me, well, it's because everyone expects me to be this way. I'm ADD, I take medicine, and they know that, and they expect me to be that. And so, you know what, instead of, I can control it, I can temper things down, but you know what I said in my mind, I'm just going to be this way, because they expect it. It's the label they put on me. I'll never forget the message that Brother Rick Bailey spoke at our church one year about labels, and Jordan came weeping and crying to me and said, I've got to remove the labels from my life. Finally connected with his spirit. It finally clicked in his mind that I can't be defined by what others say. I don't care if you're socially awkward according to the label you've been given. Some of the coolest kids are awkward. But come hang out with me. We'll play Legos, you know. Something, I don't know, or PS2 and drink Surge all night. Another story, ask Jordan about it. I burned his esophagus lining. Anyways, doesn't matter the label you've been given, if you're socially awkward or if you're the cool kid on the block, you have value. You know, I told you I'm just going to be me and be real, and I've always just spoken straight to our young people. And I actually experienced something yesterday that really bothered me. Just observed, I should say. It's in Subway. And you know who you are because you were there. I was there. And there's a group of girls coming, talking, chilling. And I'm just kind of minding my own business, waiting in line. And the group of girls were like, oh, man. Oh, look at those people out there. I hope they don't come in here. They're the cool kids. And they don't talk to us. And I don't really want them to be around us. And then they watched and watched. And I'm just observing, just kind of not minding my own business. Creeping, you know, like, selfie. And the cool kids came in. And they're like, oh, man, they're coming in. Well, you know what? Cool kids ignored them. They must have been part of the same group or knew each other or whatever. And the cool kids ignored them. And it really bothered me, really struck me. We need to embrace our own value and each other's value. You may be the cool cat, the Barbie or Ken of the youth group, or the one who's on the platform. But you know what? You may need someday the ADD kid whose mind works at a faster speed than you could ever imagine. Jordan, oh, dude's mind works like a million miles an hour. And the way he processes it, I don't get it. But the way he can think, and you may need that person in your life someday to help you understand because you can't think and understand and grasp. Some label to Jordan ADD. I label him phenomenal value with a phenomenal mind and an ability to grasp knowledge. I challenged him once. I'm like, you need to do a Bible study on that. Just look up scripture and something. I don't even remember the topic. I just threw it out there, you know. I've been his mentor. Like, you know, is he going to do it? Like, later that day, I got it done. I'm like, bro, like, sweet. Your value comes from what God has in mind for you, whether you're an imperial flagship or a Pulsar Charger. Legos have been such a popular brand for almost 60 years. They are quality, they are precise, and they hold a dominant market share of the building toy industry. Well, lo and behold, there comes the knockoffs trying to get in on the market of building blocks. Have you ever heard of Mega Bloks? Disclaimer, if you have Mega Bloks, you like them, more power to you. I still love you. I'll give you a hug. It's my brother or sister in the Lord. I'm not interested in a debate on how cool they are because, can I tell you, Mega Bloks are a knockoff. They're a weak substitute of the real thing. Let's just say I've returned 3 Mega Bloks set that were given to Josiah and bought Legos. I'm a good, good father. That's who I am. The fourth Lego lesson today is don't add your own pieces into your life that aren't from God and the real deal. Some of us don't like the pieces that we see being added into our lives. Now, Mega Bloks has some cool themes, some cool pieces, and so you might think it would be great to add them into your collection, but Mega Bloks do not have the precision of Lego, and they don't have the same measurement of Lego. They do not fit with Legos. Someone gave me a huge bin of Legos, and there were Mega Bloks in them. I know. They are no longer in my house. I donated them or something. I don't know what I did. They never have fit, and Mega Bloks will never fit with Legos. Plus, Mega Bloks are known to be unstable. Their construction, it's widely known in the building block industry. They don't have the same stability like Lego construction does. Oh, you might not like the pieces you are given in your life, but you want an unstable life? You want pieces in your life that don't really fit? Go ahead and do your own thing. Add your own pieces. Add that boyfriend or girlfriend into life that you haven't prayed about, but that's what I need. They're the pretty one. They're the good-looking one. Add that for seniors and those looking toward college. Add that college destination that doesn't even have a local church for you to attend. You want to add your own pieces in your life? You have the choice. It's the freedom God gives us. It's amazing freedom, the power of choice. But don't be surprised if there's instability in your life. If it doesn't fit and just something just doesn't seem right. Why? It's not a piece from God. Some may want the little pieces that God has given them. Oh, yeah, these are awesome things, but I want to add my own. It's a surefire way to be unstable. James 1:8, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Don't try to fit pieces in that just don't belong in your life. Amen. The feature of Lego that I've not gotten into until this Christmas, when I put them on my Christmas list, and I got, are the Lego power functions. You plug these specialized pieces into your set, and voila. This is pretty amazing. This is going to blow your mind. Wait for it. Yeah. You push a button. I'm waiting for the pieces for my holiday train set, and then I'm just going to sit down there like, yeah, watch it. I don't have to play with it. I can just push the button. Yes. I'm awesome. Everything is awesome. Lego lesson number 5, and one that Brother David Brown brought up last night, so I won't rehash things too much, is that we need to be connected to the power source. We need that refreshing from the Spirit, as our theme has been talked about this year. As my time on the Wisconsin Youth Committee comes to a close and I look back over the last 10 plus years, you know what the hardest part has been? It hasn't been the late nights at Winter Youth, although that gets harder and harder. Man, this year I'm like, Jesus, take the wheel. It hasn't been all the work that goes into youth camp, all the forms I have to process. Sorry about Eventbrite, all you chaperones. Please forgive me and all the information you had to add. Or the section rallies. It hasn't been that. The hardest part has been that I've been forced to watch young people and young adults come, be a part, and then walk away. Hear my heart today, Wisconsin. We have to be plugged in to the power source. We can build and build and try to create this masterpiece on our own, or create this monster life, the perfect life, the life of the world. And I got to have this. I got to have that. I got to have the job. I got to have, and all those things are fine and dandy. Even we can try and build the life of ministry and involvement. That's what I'm supposed to do. So I'm going to just plug myself in and be a servant. Praise God for that. I appreciate all those who are. But if we're not connected, Mark 8:36, for what shall it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his own soul? You can lose your soul being involved, even. You can lose your soul focusing on everything on your education, everything on your relationships, everything on your financial status. Our heart's cry should be the lyrics to the old song, above all else, I must be saved. We need to go all out to make sure heaven is our home. And that will only happen through staying connected. How, as Brother Brown said last night, show me your friends, I'll show you your future. You need to surround yourself with those who will carry you. He talked about that. But second, another thought I had was important is to submit yourself in accountability to someone. Someone who has veto power in your life, who can call your bluff, who when you're pulling the front and acting all spiritual, they can be like, what's the true motive behind you? Jordan, at age 13 or 14, I taught on accountability. Didn't expect anyone to actually follow through. And sure enough, the next week, I heard what you said. Would you hold me accountable? I want to submit myself to you and talk to you and meet with you. And if I do anything, he submitted himself. I'm like, wow. Now, after 12 years of me just totally pounding him, he probably regrets it. But I'm no one special, just a normal guy. But he's allowed me to speak into his life. A few years ago, he faced a very dark hour in it. It was the few minutes I spent hearing him out, propping him up,
supporting him, helping him to have the right attitude, spirit, making sure he was connected through that dark hour. I know that's one thing that helped him through. I wasn't the answer, but he still gives me a card every year at the same time thanking me. Again, I'm nothing special. I don't even know what I said. Probably, it's all right, Jordan. You're going to be fine, Jordan. Stay connected to God. Keep praying. And I don't know. He makes it seem like it's all wise. It's, I don't know. But his mind moves faster than mine, so he probably is way ahead of me. Anyways, he's the wise one for making sure he has surrounded himself with folks who would help him stay connected. The musicians could come. We can learn a lot from Legos this morning. If you would stand with me. Number one, you're a masterpiece in progress. He has the perfect pieces, the perfect plan for your life. Number two, there's no instructions to see the final product. So just trust God with the next piece. Don't try to figure it all out on your own. Lesson number three, your value comes from what God has in mind, not the label we give ourselves or we are given by others. And lesson number four, non-Lego pieces don't work. Avoid the instability and pieces that will just never truly fit. And lastly, and most importantly, stay connected. Stay connected to Jesus. Don't walk away from him. You can blame all you want on situation and circumstances and life happenings. Sometimes it's a slow fade, as that song said. You just get so busy. But whatever you have to do, stay connected. Surround yourself with people to hold you connected. This last year, in the last 6 months, this young couple who had such a bright future tried to pour myself into them. Had them part of a mentorship group, ministry mentorship group. But the one thing I noticed is they never were truly honest. They never really opened up. You would try and prod. Last 6 months, they just stopped coming. Such potential. Such potential for God to create a masterpiece. And they've walked away. I don't know why. Because they've never, ever opened up and shared the hard things that are going in life, maybe. So stay connected. Find some. I challenge you, find someone to be accountable to. It's not, hey, would you hold me accountable and expect them to come to you every time? But you submit to accountability. You say, I'm going to meet with you. I'm going to, if it's simply saying, Pastor, can I go grocery shopping with you? I used to take our kids grocery shopping. Why? Because it's something we can hang out and do and talk, and it's casual. You'll probably blow your pastor's mind, and he'll probably feel awkward, like, groceries? But ask him, hey, can I mow your lawn and maybe spend some time? Can I, whatever it may be, get somebody in your life who's going to keep you grounded, going to keep you connected, can keep you plugged in. Hallelujah. Lego lessons from P. Hill. With that, as they begin to sing, I just want to encourage you to find a place to pray. Whatever lesson was talked about this morning that connected with you, talk to the Lord about it. Say, God, how do I apply that in my life? How do I just trust you with the perfect plan that I, you know, God, maybe it's a trust issue. Maybe, God, I'm just trying to figure everything out and I just need to let go. Maybe I do have value issues and I just need to know, find my value in you. Maybe I've been trying to add things in my life and God wants to work those pieces out of your life and put the right ones in. Maybe you aren't connected. I want to encourage you again. You can receive the Holy Ghost this morning. You can be refreshed. The winds of refreshing. Let them sweep over your soul. So as we begin to sing, won't you come? Won't you find a place to pray this morning?
I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me.
I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away.
Allow him to speak to you this morning.
I give myself away so you can use me.
Some of you have more issues in your life.
Give myself away, so.